Good evening and welcome to Northern Kentucky History Hour. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We are so glad to have you. Everyone on Facebook, glad to have you joining us via the live stream, and everyone in Zoom. We're just letting the rest of our Zoom audience in here tonight, and then we will get started momentarily with Northern Kentucky History Hour. All right. If you're just joining us via Zoom or Facebook, this is Northern Kentucky History Hour. Tonight, we will be talking about William Goebel, Northern Kentucky's only governor for about 3 days. So thank you so much for joining us. You will find that your microphone is muted. But we really encourage you to enter any questions you have either into the chat if you're in Zoom or onto the comments if you're joining us via Facebook. All right, and it looks like we've got the majority of our audience here on Zoom. So those on Facebook, thanks for bearing with us. I'm gonna go ahead and add a couple of details. Let's see here. My name is Tara Johnson Gnome, and I'm a member of the Board of Trustees for Behringer-Crawford Museum. Northern Kentucky History Hour is a project that the museum decided to start during the pandemic. This is episode 38, and we are so happy to see many members of the museum with us tonight, and many of you who've been joining every single week. If you're new to History Hour, just a couple of housekeeping items. As I said before, we will be keeping microphones muted, but please ask questions, add comments in the chat. We'll let you know this is being recorded. And so if you do not want your video recorded, you should you can turn your video off. It's in the bottom left-hand corner of your Zoom, or in the top right-hand corner, depending on your device. So you can turn your video off if you would like. I wanna thank a number of organizations and people for making this project possible. First, Behringer-Crawford staff. They have been absolutely instrumental in getting this project going and being successful. Also want to thank all the other trustees. I see a number of BCM trustees here tonight, so thanks to them. And thank you so much to the organizations that support Behringer-Crawford Museum financially. We are supported by the City of Covington, Kenton County Fiscal Court, ArtsWave, the Kentucky Arts Council, the Northern Kentucky Sports Hall of Fame, and the Carol Ann and Ralph B. Hale Jr. U.S. Bank Foundation. Thanks to all of them, and thank you so much to our members. As I said earlier, we are so grateful that many of you have become members over the past year, and we just want to say thank you. If you're not a member yet, you can learn out how to become a member at bcmuseum.org. I'll also put in a quick plug for all of the other virtual programming the museum has to offer. Curator of Collections, Jason French, has regular curators chats that are available on Facebook and at our YouTube channel. And they are wonderful ways to get more in depth about all of the excellent exhibits that are continuing to go on at the museum, which by the way, is now open. So without further ado, I am so pleased to introduce you to our two guests tonight. Sometimes we only have one speaker, but we are lucky enough to have two this evening, and I'm going to introduce both of them, and then they are going to start their presentation together and go back and forth. So we have Robert Schrage, or Bob as I know him. Bob Schrage is very active in local history circles, has served on the boards of Rabbit Hash Historical Society, Boone County Historic Preservation Board, and the Behringer-Crawford Museum Board. In 2015, Schrage received the William Conrad Preservation Excellence Award for Lifetime Achievement in Preservation of Local History. Previous works of his include Lost Northern Kentucky, Legendary Locals of Covington, which he actually presented on for a previous History Hour, Eyewitness to History, a Personal Journal, which has won many awards, and Carl Kiger, The Man Beyond the Murder, The Ohio River from Cincinnati to Louisville, and Boone County Then and Now, and as well as Burlington. John Schaaf retired as executive director of the Kentucky Legislative Ethics Commission, where he worked for 15 years. And he served on the steering committee of the International Council on Governmental Ethics Laws. Prior to that, he was the general counsel for the Legislative Research Commission, as well as an attorney with a Louisville law firm, and a brief stint as editor of a weekly paper. Schaaf received a journalism degree from the University of Kentucky and his JD from the Louis D. Brandeis School of Law at the University of Louisville. So Bob and John, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having us. Let me first of all share the screen for the PowerPoint presentation, and you can confirm that it's up on the screen. So is it there?
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much for having us today. The structure of tonight's presentation is I'm going to spend a few minutes talking about William Goebel's earlier or pre-elected official time and some of the influences of his childhood and being a young adult and how it affected his later political career. So I'm going to focus on that. And then John is going to spend the rest of the program and the bulk of the program really talking about things that led up to, from his political career all the way to his fateful election to governor and eventual assassination and stuff. So that's the time frame and the structure. And right away, the PowerPoint is not going to the next picture. So that's not good. Bear with me one second. Same frame up there, right?
Yeah, can you hit the forward arrow maybe?
Huh. I don't know why that's doing that. Well, let me stop the share real quick. I apologize. I know how to make it work. Just bear with me. Let me get it.
No problem.
All right. Is that there? No. Okay. Let me share the. I think I might have the same problem after we go to the next picture, but.
It looks good now.
Yeah, but I'm not sure it's going to click when I do it. But let me go ahead, because we're going to keep that picture up here for the first five to 10 minutes anyway. So okay. Then I can work on it while John is talking. But I want to start out with, William Goebel, whose middle name was Justice, was born in 1856. He was born in Pennsylvania, actually. A lot of people don't necessarily know that, to Wilhelm and Augusta Goebel, and they were immigrants from Hanover, Germany. And Goebel was the first of their four children, and he was actually born, he weighed less than 3 pounds when he was born. He was a couple months premature. And one of the early influences on Goebel that had a tremendous impact on his political career and the issues that he stood for was the fact that his father served as a private in the Pennsylvania Infantry Regiment during the American Civil War. Now this is, William is only 6 and 7 years old at this time. And during the Civil War, Goebel's mother really raised the children on her own and concentrated a lot about teaching the Goebel children, or particularly William, about their German heritage. And I'll get back to it in a minute, but this, Goebel's father was on the Union side, obviously, in what I was just saying, and that had a tremendous impact. They were decidedly pro-Union family, and I'll get back to that. Now, William, as a child, only spoke German all the way up until he was probably 5 or 6 years old, and when his father was discharged from the army in 1863, that's when they moved to Covington. Now, Wilhelm, the father, was was generally, he was pretty much a common laborer, and he worked as a as a common laborer, and he worked as a store worker, and probably his most skilled occupation was as a cabinet maker. And during this time, you're going to find out in a second that Wilhelm died fairly early in William's life. But, during a good part of his father's life, William was educating himself. He attended school in Covington, and he apprenticed at an early age with a jeweler in Cincinnati. And he also sold newspapers and things like that at the time, which is probably a common occupation for a kid. But he wasn't an apprentice in the jeweler very long, because after a brief time at a business college, he became an apprentice in the law firm of John W. Stevenson. And Stevenson is one of the several people who were very prominent Northern Kentuckians that Goebel was going to come in contact with. Stevenson served as governor of Kentucky from 1871 to 1877, and he was Northern Kentucky's only other governor. There's only two governors from Northern Kentucky, counting Goebel and Stevenson. So, at the same time that he was joining this firm in 1877, his father died. And one of Goebel's, it's interesting because there was always some controversy around Goebel's statements that he was raised poor, he was born poor, he was raised poor, and his family never had a lot of money. He would always, as a politician, espouse this populist sort of theme. And but there was always controversy to it. Not everybody bought that completely. And one of the area newspapers at the time of Wilhelm's death said that his father was one of the most prominent and highly respected German citizens of Covington. So, that sort of contradicts that and would later breed into the controversy a little bit. But more significantly, and that's probably not a good way to say it, but very significantly in his life also was a few years later when his mother died. And so in his early 20s, Goebel became the guardian of his two younger siblings. And he was very shocked by the death of his mother. And it greatly influenced him from a personal standpoint. Now Goebel was described as a very hardworking person. I mean, very, very well read as a child and as an adult. And he was very hardworking, even at an early age. He was very ambitious and intelligent. And these are traits that would really stay with him throughout his whole life. And in fact, one of the things we'll learn about Goebel as a politician that made him really stand out, because he didn't have the personality of a politician. We'll get to that, but his intelligence really made him stand out. And so eventually Goebel, as I said, went in with Stevenson. They became very close. In fact, he was the executor of Stevenson's estate. Now, Goebel graduated from law school the same year as his father died in 1877. And then he enrolled in college after that. And then he came into contact with John G. Carlyle, who we all know the name from Covington. And this is really a second person in which Goebel came into contact, which was not only, like Stevenson, a prominent Northern Kentuckian, but a prominent American and had a national reputation. I mean, we know Carlyle was a lieutenant governor. He was a U.S. House member. He was Speaker of the House. And unfortunately, in a way, under Cleveland, President Cleveland, he was Secretary of Treasury. Right, of course, when a big depression and major problems hit, and he got a lot of the economic blame for that. But after a few years with Carlyle, he was back with Stevenson, and this is where the story gets really interesting, and has a great impact on Goebel and which will lead to the assassination and the issues related to that that John's going to talk about. But it was in Stevenson's law firm on the second stint that Goebel really, he learned railroad law and practiced, and he practiced many cases related against railroad companies, and particularly, and this is very significant, against the Louisville and Nashville Railroad. And so it's very significant that he did that. And we'll come back and talk about that. Now, he was director of a bank, but from a personal standpoint, Goebel was never known as a real friendly person, lack of a better, in public. I mean, he belonged to few social organizations, you know, and unless you were really a good friend of his, you know, he probably didn't greet you with, he probably only gave his closest friends a big smile and a big handshake when he saw him on the street or whatever. You know, Goebel lived very simply. He resided in boarding houses and apartments on 6th and 7th Street in Covington. You know, he was never romantically linked, you know, to a woman, and is the only bachelor to ever serve as the governor of Kentucky. He never married. And he started to develop in the 1880s, he really focused on his work, and he really focused on a new interest in politics. And in 1880, there was a thing called the Democratic Club that started, and he became the first secretary of that. And it was just 4 years later that he was executive director of the, secretary of the, he was on the Democratic Executive Committee, you know, right away. And going back to what I said earlier, Goebel really advocated when he became interested in politics, and he became an elected official later, for the civil rights for women and blacks, and for more effective railroad regulation, restrictions on toll roads. You know, he believed in getting rid of the lotteries and pool halls, and expansion of workers' rights. And he was different, and John will tell you this, particularly on the issues of former slaves and blacks. He was not in tune with the rest of the state. Kentucky was neutral, maybe even a little pro-Northern in the Civil War, but certainly after the Civil War, it became very Southern, very pro-Confederate. A lot of violence in the state of Kentucky to keep African-Americans from integrating into society and having the laws, the various amendments to the Constitution offered and such. However, I will say that his positions were much more attuned to Northern Kentucky than they were the rest of the state. Northern Kentucky was more, I think it's fair to say, was much more pro-union than the rest of the state. So while he was out of touch with the rest of the state, he was probably a little more in touch with Northern Kentucky. So a few more things about Goebel. He was a quiet person. Irving S. Cobb, the journalist, said that I read this online, that he called him a sort of reptilian, while others said that he was, you know, he had a sharp nose as a physical feature and sort of humorless eyes. But he wasn't a great speaker, but he did have that deep, powerful voice and a real forceful delivery that would help him drive home his points and stuff. So while lacking a lot of social qualities that were common to politicians, as I said before, you know, what really drove Goebel and made him successful and put him in the position to possibly be elected governor was his intelligence. He was well-read, you know, and his supporters and his opponents both conceded that, his intelligence was very impressive. And in fact, Cobb said he was probably the most intelligent man he'd ever met. So I think that's a heck of a compliment in a big part. So, you know, he was a very complex man. He was a very ambitious man. Some people denounced him as ruthless, hostile, heartless, and other people said he was a dedicated reformer. And, you know, so maybe he's an enigma. Maybe he's both of these. I guess that's for us to try to, you know, try to conclude. But there were a lot of influences in his life. And I think we've talked about that, from civil rights to reading, to his mom, you know, to Stevenson, to, you know, particularly the railroad. So I'm going to jump ahead and then turn it over to John. But I did want to talk briefly about an incident that happened in 1895 that John's not going to talk about, but it is important to understand Goebel. And it was in 1895, after he was already an elected official, in what he engaged in, what many people labeled or considered a duel with a guy named John Sanford. Now, Sanford was a Confederate general staff officer, and he turned a banker, and he clashed with Goebel many times. I mean, this is oil and water, these two men. And Goebel's successful campaign to remove tolls as an elected official from Kentucky turnpikes cost Sanford a lot of money. He was associated with a big turnpike company. A lot of their money was in his bank. And many people believe that Sanford blocked Goebel's appointment to the Kentucky Court of Appeals, which at the time was the state's highest court. And so that didn't sit real well. So incensed by that, Goebel wrote an article in the newspaper where he called Sanford Gonorrhea John, among other things, very personal attacks. And the climax came when Goebel and two acquaintances, one which was the Attorney General of the state of Kentucky, they were in Covington, they were going to cash a check, and Goebel suggested they avoid Sanford's bank. But Sanford was standing outside the First National Bank on Madison Avenue. Now, that's not his bank, but that's just the bank that he was standing in front of. And, you know, he spoke to the men before they could cross the street. Sanford greeted Goebel's friends, offered his left hand, and then Goebel noticed that in his pocket, he had his hand in his pocket on a revolver, and it was concealed in his pocket. Now, Goebel was armed himself, so he reached into his pocket, and then both men drew their pistols, and no one was really sure who shot first. Witnesses said they shot simultaneously. Well, Sanford's bullet passed through Goebel's coat and ripped his trousers and left him uninjured. Goebel's bullet hit Sanford, fatally struck him in the head, you know, and he died, you know, hours later, and it hit him in the left eye in an upward projection. I think Sanford was standing on steps, because then he fell on the steps and his face was, I think, down in the steps. Well, Goebel, following this shooting, simply walked down, I think it was Fifth Street, down towards Scott Street to the police station. And he walked into the police station, you know, bystanders are back at the other place helping Sanford. And Goebel entered the police station, immediately went into a phone booth and called his brother. Then he came out of the phone booth and said to the police officer, "I suppose you heard of it." The officer said, "Yes." Goebel said it was self-defense and that Sanford had, you know, tried to kill him, and Goebel surrendered himself. He turned in his 38 caliber Smith and Wessons and Wesson and this is an incident that haunted Goebel for much of his career. Goebel pleaded self-defense and charges were dismissed because of reasonable doubt in the examining trial. The grand jury failed to indict, and later Mrs. Sanford sued him for $10,000, but the jury refused to find for her. And like I said, it haunted him the rest of his life. Interestingly, I think an interesting tidbit is that, you know, if he had been charged with dueling, he would not have been eligible to hold public office, because we all Kentuckians, if they're going to be an officer or in office, have to swear that they've never fought a duel to this day. So it would have made, if they had been charged that way, he would have been ineligible for his office, never would have ran for governor. So anyway, with that said, that's just a quick nut bolt of some of his early stuff. I know that many of you want to get to the nuts, the real juicy stuff of the campaign. So I'm going to turn that over to John, and then I'm going to try to fix this PowerPoint presentation while you're talking, John.
Okay, thanks, Bob. I hope that people let me know if they can't hear me. Goebel, it's really been interesting learning about Goebel. He was a towering figure in Kentucky history, and he accomplished this status in a relatively short period of time. He was only an elected official in the Kentucky State Senate for about 13 years. He ran in a special election to fill the seat vacated by State Senator James Bryan, who ran for lieutenant governor in 1887, another Covingtonian who became a lieutenant governor. There were three of them, actually, in just a relatively short period of time. That was probably the apex of Northern Kentucky's influence on statewide politics in Kentucky. But Goebel, as Bob said, as a lawyer, was a vigorous advocate for primarily for injured railroad employees. He had learned a lot of railroad law in his younger years, and when he was out on his own, he was practicing a lot of cases against the L&N Railroad, representing their injured workers who didn't have any other recourse when they were hurt on the job or they were killed and their families needed compensation. There was no workers' compensation in those days, so their only choice was to go to court against the railroad, which was historically a pretty much a losing proposition. Goebel, however, with his background in railroad law, understood how to take on the L&N Railroad, and he said, at least, he never lost a case against the railroad. So he became really known as the railroad lawyer and really the people's lawyer. So when he ran for this state Senate seat, he barely won in the special election in 1887 because a third party candidate got in the race who had the backing of some of people who would probably have supported Goebel. But once he was in Frankfort as a state senator, he continued his battles with the L&N, only it was in a different arena. This time it was in the state legislature. Not only that, but in 1890, Goebel was selected to serve in the Kentucky Constitutional Convention, drafting a new constitution, revising the 1850 Constitution. And in service in that Constitutional Convention, Goebel played a key role in getting a lot of language in that constitution regulating corporations, particularly railroads. For example, the Railroad Commission, which many of you might remember from earlier days when it was repealed from the Kentucky Constitution probably 20 years ago, but in the 1890s, 1880s, 1890s, it was an important check on the power of the railroads in Kentucky, especially the L&N. It was a three-member board elected by the people, and they were able to serve as somewhat of a counterbalance to the railroad's incredible power, especially in the General Assembly. I think the railroad, especially the L&N, was probably the first organized and well-funded lobbying organization in the Kentucky General Assembly. Very powerful, a lot of influence that they would use to get what they wanted out of the General Assembly. So Goebel wrote some checks into the state constitution, which remained there for about 100 years and were very important in those early days. But as you can imagine, the L&N Railroad developed a real animosity toward Goebel. And it was serious, but you can't think of Goebel's historic role in Kentucky without thinking of his opposition to the L&N because of their power at the time. And it was sort of a David and Goliath question. And Goebel won more than his share of his battles with the L&N Railroad. One of the first battles he waged in the legislature was actually investigating the L&N's lobbying activities and with the General Assembly. And Goebel headed up a committee investigating the railroad, and they found a lot of wrongdoing by railroad lobbyists who were giving out freebies to legislators and generally wielding some influence in some inappropriate ways. Goebel even recommended that the lobbyists be indicted by a Franklin County grand jury, which apparently never happened, but it was a real smack in the face, again, from Goebel to the railroads. He spent most of his legislative career, again, which wasn't that long, it was only about 12 or 13 years, in the Kentucky State Senate, but he was in the majority, and he eventually became the president, at they called it at the time, the president pro tem of the Kentucky State Senate, the number one person in the Senate. The actual president of the Senate then was the lieutenant governor, who didn't actually serve in the body. So Goebel was very influential. He had an interesting political rise because he came out of the Democratic Party, of course, which for most of the 1800s after the Civil War was in the control of pro-Confederate people, former Confederate officers and people who had supported the Confederacy in the Civil War. And they ran the Democratic Party along with a lot of conservative Republicans who came back from the Civil War, fighting the Civil War, and were opposed to emancipation. And they were opposed to equal rights for Blacks in the post-Civil War era. So they banded together with these former Confederates, and they pretty much ran government in Kentucky until 1895. Now, while Goebel was in the state Senate, a Republican was elected governor, William Bradley, first Republican governor in Kentucky. And of course, in those days, the governor was term limited, so Bradley could only serve one term. And Goebel, as the Senate president pro tem, was concerned about Bradley's victory in 1895, which was followed by William McKinley's victory, a Republican, in Kentucky in the presidential race of 1896. So with that in mind, and with the power that he wielded, Goebel pushed through a statute which became known as the Goebel Election Law. And it set up a board of election commissioners that was appointed by the legislature, which of course was controlled by the Democrats. So there was a lot of, I think Goebel got a bad, I'd say it was an overtly partisan move, which I don't think helped Goebel when he ran for governor in 1899. But that was another factor in the very contentious governor's race in 1899, which of course, as I said, with this first Republican governor, Bradley, and a Republican attorney general, Taylor, the Democrats were very adamant about getting back into power, which they'd lost. So it was shaping up as a contentious election anyway. And then Goebel managed to survive a six-day Democratic convention that was held over in Louisville that in which he cut a lot of deals, which he was really good at. As Bob said, he wasn't much of a stump speaker as a politician, but he excelled in backroom deals and just wielding power, gaining power. And he was a pretty incredible politician, given his relatively young age and not a whole lot of experience. But he climbed to the very top. And in the governor's race in 1899, the Republicans nominated. They had a rather contentious convention as well, because Governor Bradley had been fairly supportive of equal rights, or at least more civil rights for Black Americans, whereas Taylor, the Attorney General, was kind of the opposite. He was running against what was called at the time Black Republicanism, and he was not as interested in civil rights. Goebel, of course, was, and Goebel was sort of riding a populist wave that was sweeping the country, starting in the late 1880s, and you know, the enactment of the Sherman Antitrust Act in 1890, and sort of a corporate, anti-corporate populist wave that benefited Goebel in his climb, even though most of Kentucky was not fully supportive of some of his. He was, for example, also very favorable toward voting rights for women in Board of Education races. They were not, of course, they didn't have the right to vote until 1920 when the U.S. Constitution was amended, but Goebel was very supportive of limited voting rights, which was unusual in those days. But in the general election, of course, McKinley, the president, was very supportive of Taylor, and Goebel brought in William Jennings Bryan, who had been McKinley's opponent in 1896 and was aiming to run again for president in 1900. So Bryan was hugely popular, of course, throughout the country, and particularly with Democrats. And he and Goebel mounted a railroad, a train expedition from Western Kentucky all the way to Newport, going through Louisville and or to Covington. And that lasted about 5 days and turned out over 200,000 people at various stops along the way. Kind of ironic when you think about Goebel's antipathy toward the railroads that that this would be such an important aspect of his election. But as the election grew closer, both sides were, it might remind you of some more recent events, both sides were concerned about fraud on the part of the other party. And they were making a lot of allegations. And of course, in those days, Eastern Kentucky was heavily Republican, which went back to the Civil War days. And Louisville and Western Kentucky were much more heavily Democratic, and Northern Kentucky. So there were a lot of fraud allegations. The governor, again, a Republican, called out the state militia for election day to, he said, to keep the peace. The mayor of Louisville, on the other hand, a Democrat, called out over 500 Louisville police officers, and he said that was to keep the peace. But both sides accused the other of trying to intimidate the other party's voters with this show of force and brandishing of weapons at the polling places. And so the election, on election night, Goebel had a razor thin margin because most of the reporting was from the urban areas and from Western Kentucky. The mountains were much slower to turn in their votes. And so over a period of several days, as the Republican votes rolled in from the Eastern Kentucky counties, Taylor took a slim lead and ended up winning the election by about 2,000 votes out of over 400,000 cast. So a very narrow margin, which of course the Democrats were alleging fraud in Eastern Kentucky. They said the ballots were actually just tissue paper, which could be thrown away if the correct ballot wasn't cast. And they also accused the L&N Railroad of illegally putting money into the race. And several years later, the L&N Railroad chairman, board chairman, did admit that the LNN spent $500,000 in that campaign. And he said they would have spent more if they thought it was needed. And that was about $16 million in today's money. So the LNN continued their opposition to Goebel right up until the end. Now, Goebel at first appeared accepting of the of Taylor's victory. And he said he was going to go to Arizona to visit his brother. But with Democrats still in control of the legislature, the Democratic Party convinced Goebel to file an election contest in the General Assembly, which was an unusual move, of course, but not it was contemplated by the state constitution that the General Assembly could resolve election contests. And so when the General Assembly convened at the 1st of January in 1900, the first week, Goebel filed his contest, and along with him, his lieutenant governor candidate, J.C.W. Beckham, also filed a contest in his race, which was in those days separate from the governor's race. So the General Assembly randomly selected a committee, a 10-member committee, to look into the election and come up with a recommendation for the General Assembly. Well, the 10-member committee randomly selected turned out to be 9 Democrats and 1 Republican. So that immediately cast a lot of a doubt on, you know, at least from the standpoint of the Republicans, about what was going to happen here. So the LNN Railroad organized thousands of Eastern Kentuckians to come to, all men, of course, to come to Frankfort to act as witnesses in this election contest, ostensibly. So they came, and most of them came armed, and they set up encampments around Frankfort, particularly around what we now call the old capital in Frankfort, but was then the state capital. The downtown Frankfort essentially became an armed camp. That was part of the militia that was actually there to protect the capital, I guess. But during this election contest, it went on for several weeks. Of course, the tension was really high because a lot of people expected violence regardless of the outcome. And of course, with all these armed individuals outside, that became more of a reality. Most of the hearings on this were held over at the Old Capitol Hotel, which was about 2 blocks from the Old Capitol. And in fact, about 2.5 weeks into the election contest, a gunfight broke out in the lobby of the hotel, and 3 men were killed and 3 others were injured. And a lot of people, according to the papers, a lot of people thought it was the beginning of the rioting that they were sure was going to accompany this election contest. But anyway, so you can imagine the tension in Frankfort during this period of time. So around January 30th, the election contest was winding up, and Goebel, this was on January 30th, actually, Goebel was heading from his room at the Old Capitol Hotel. It was about a 2-block walk across the railroad tracks and up Broadway to the Old Capitol. And Goebel's making the walk with a couple of people who I guess were his friends, but they also acted as his bodyguards. And as they were walking up the front walk in front of the Capitol, a shot was fired from that adjoining building you see in the picture there. That was actually the, was called at the time, the executive office building or the state office building, where state officials had their offices. Well, one of those state officials was the new Secretary of State, a fellow named Caleb Powers, a Republican, and from Eastern Kentucky. And so the shot was apparently fired from his window, which was on the corner of the building, or on the side of the building facing the Old Capitol. And Goebel was hit, and he was walking behind one of his bodyguards, and his other bodyguard was to his left. And so Goebel was hit, and he went down, and his bodyguards said, "Goebel, they've killed you." And Goebel said, "I guess they have." And of course, he went down. He wasn't dead. He was carried back to his room at the Old Capitol Hotel. And the doctor who examined him later said he knew it was a fatal wound as soon as he saw it. Goebel was hit basically near the heart, not in the heart, near the heart, and the bullet passed through and went out his back. And if you visit the History Center in Frankfort, the Kentucky History Center, you can see the jacket he was wearing. There it is, with a hole in the back where the bullet escaped. So Goebel, of course, is egregiously wounded. He's not unconscious, but he's in his bed in the Capitol Hotel. The legislature, of course, is in chaos. The governor designates it as a state of insurrection that's going on, and he blocks the Capitol. This is later in the day. He blocks the Capitol. The legislature can't get back into the building. The militia has been called out for this state of insurrection. They keep the legislature out of the building. The legislature, the governor tries to dissolve the legislature. He declares them dissolved and says that he will reconvene them down in London, Kentucky, of course, in the heart of the Republican area of Eastern Kentucky. He says he'll call them back into session in 2 weeks, but they're dissolved. Of course, the majority Democrats don't buy that, and they try to get together to meet. And this creates what I kind of think of as almost a comic scene. You've got a bunch of these old guys, legislators, who are essentially running from place to place in Frankfort, trying to get there before the militia so they can get in. Of course, the militia, being more numerous and probably younger than the legislators, was staking out every place where the legislators were trying to go and keeping them from getting in. The legislators tried to get into the county courthouse. They tried to get into the opera house. They tried to get into the city hall, and they were unsuccessful all over the period of several hours. So the next day, they are able to convene at the Capitol Plaza, at the Old Capitol Hotel in the ballroom. They arrived there, or they were staying there, you know, one by one or in small groups. They didn't try to enter all in one big group. So the militia couldn't keep them out and apparently didn't even know they were meeting. And so in this meeting, they resolved the election contest in favor of Goebel, who's right upstairs on his deathbed. And so they vote as they are authorized to do by the Constitution. The Senate House both vote that Goebel is the winner of the gubernatorial election. Now, of course, Taylor, his opponent, had already been sworn in back in December because he had the most votes. Well, now the legislature was overturning this election. Goebel is sworn in immediately upstairs by a judge, signs an order disbanding the militia, sending them home. And then a day and a half later, he's dead. And his lieutenant governor, Beckham, who was also designated the winner by the legislature, is sworn in immediately. And so for a certain period of time, a few days, Kentucky ostensibly has two governors. An agreement is sort of reached by which Taylor will resign. Now, this was between top Republicans and top Democrats. But Taylor didn't buy that. He didn't buy that agreement. He went to court, and he said he was in a court declared Beckham or Goebel the winner and Beckham the governor. And so this became one of the most important cases actually in U.S. history. The Kentucky Court of Appeals Kentucky's highest court, decided that indeed the legislature has the power to resolve election contests. And when they did that in favor of Goebel, he became the legally empowered governor. And when he died, his lieutenant governor was the legally authorized governor. And of course, Taylor was not satisfied with that. Who would be? So he appealed to the US Supreme Court. And in a case that was resolved in a matter of, they resolved it in May. So this was just a couple of months later. They upheld the Kentucky Supreme Court, basically found that under Kentucky's state constitution, the legislature had acted legally and declared Goebel the governor. Several people were convicted of conspiracy to murder Goebel, including Caleb Powers, the Secretary of State. Taylor, the governor, actually decided he better leave the state because he thought he was going to get indicted as part of the conspiracy. So he left, went to Indiana. Indiana's governor would not send him back to Kentucky in the face of any legal charges. So Taylor stayed in Indianapolis the rest of his life and practiced law there for the rest of his life. Powers, who was convicted, actually went through three trials, was convicted, then the conviction was overturned. He was tried again, convicted. And when he was getting ready to undergo the third trial, he was pardoned by a subsequent governor, Wilson, who followed Beckham into office and was a Republican. So he pardoned everybody, including Powers and including Jim Howard, who I guess you say was he was the shooter in this thing. He had come up that morning from Eastern Kentucky on a train, brought his rifle with him, and apparently was allowed into Caleb Powers' office and fired the shot that killed Goebel. And he was also pardoned by Governor Wilson. So, and Beckham, since Beckham became governor so early in Goebel's term, a special election was scheduled for November of 1900. And Beckham won that fairly comfortably and became governor for the next 3 years. So that's the story of the armed encampment and a contested election. You can kind of see how elections can really cause unrest when you have especially one side thinking that there was fraudulent activity by the other side. And I think we saw that played out pretty recently.
Yes, absolutely. History can definitely provide some interesting feedback, right, about present day. That was so fascinating. I actually was taking a lot of notes just because I was trying to keep up with you all. I think we did get a copy of the book, but Bob, maybe, or John, if you all want to, I know you had it on your last slide, but if you want to add into the chat how somebody can go about getting the book. There it is. Yes, we did get our copy. That's right.
Exactly.
That is great. We did have some questions, and I am going to do my best to, let's see, get all of those to you all. I'm trying to see here if we can, here we go, have a quick conversation. Sorry, just kind of playing around with the image here for a second. So let's see. Okay, first question. These are actually, a lot of questions are from Facebook tonight. You were talking early in the conversation about John Sanford and the problems between him and Goebel. And I was just, one of our viewers was wondering, the town, Sanford Town in Kentucky, was that named for that John Sanford?
You know, I have, that's a great question. I'm gonna have to research that. I have, absolutely no idea. Is Sanford Town in Northern Kentucky, isn't it? Or is it?
I actually am not familiar with Sanford Town personally. So I am not 100% sure about that.
The bottom line is I do not know.
Cool. But he says it is. Heidi Overwhite says it is.
Yeah. Oh, it was. Oh, I'm sorry.
It's near Edgewood.
Oh, really?
Sanford Alley. Okay. Yeah. That's interesting.
That's very interesting.
He was a big businessman there. I don't think he was ever elected to any office. I believe he may have served in the Civil War on the Confederate side.
He did.
And he was certainly part of the Confederate power base in the Democratic Party for 35 years after the Civil War.
Gotcha. Okay. Thanks to Jeanine Kreinbrink and Heidi Overwine, we now know where Sanford Town is, so I apologize. See, I'm still learning every day when we do this. Sanford Town is near Edgewood at the intersection of Kentucky 17 and I-275 there at the bottom of Dudley Road. So thanks everybody for, see, this is why we have such a great audience, is because everybody else participates and helps us join in. All right, another question. And this is not exactly how the question was asked, but you kind of answered it. So I'm gonna kind of go a little bit of a different way. You mentioned in the beginning, well, at some point that, you know, Goebel ended up having involvement during the Constitutional Convention about creating some, you know, ways that elections were actually handled. And I was just curious, you know, with the ability, with the Supreme Court ruling that the legislature did have the ability to overturn that election, was that related to some of the things that he put in? I mean, because he did not win the popular vote, correct? I mean, it was overturned.
That's right. Actually, the Goebel election law was a statute.
Okay.
Goebel was involved in drafting the Constitution that was approved by the voters in 1891 and which we still operate under. Of course, it's been amended extensively, but we still have our Constitution is the 1891 Constitution. He was involved in the Constitutional Convention. The chairman of that was actually Cassius Marcellus Clay, the abolitionist, who by that time was about 80 years old, 75 years old, hadn't yet married his 15-year-old fiance, I think, at that point, which he did, I think, when he was 80. But he was not in elective office at the time. He had served in the legislature, but he was such a towering figure in Kentucky, they selected him to chair the Constitutional Convention in 1890. And Goebel served in that convention with other citizens and legislators. He was important. Goebel was key to getting a lot of regulatory language in the Constitution. But the Goebel election law came up in 1898, I believe, when Goebel pushed the bill through to call for the legislature to appoint a state board of election commissioners, which of course would be all Democrats. Now that board actually, right after the Goebel-Taylor election, that board actually found in favor of Taylor, even though they were three Democrats, two of them voted that Taylor was legally elected. It was after that that Goebel filed his election contest. And I think they abolished that board later because it was, you know, so prone to partisanship being appointed by the legislature. So.
Interesting. Okay. I know we're running a little short on time, but we've got a couple of questions. So maybe we'll try to be succinct when I ask them. What about Henry Eckert Yountsey? He served 17 years in prison for the murder. Any additional comments about him?
He was, I believe he was an employee I didn't realize he served that long. I think he was an employee in the Secretary of State's office and was convicted of being one of the conspirators. I would have thought he would have been pardoned with the other ones, probably in the early 1900s, maybe 1905, 1906. But I did run across his name, but I don't know what his role was other than probably allowing Jim Howard into the office and maybe setting him up as the, you know, in a place to actually fire the shot from.
Right. Interesting. And then
He was in fact jailed for 18 years.
Interesting.
Yeah.
But for some reason he didn't get pardoned with everybody else. Fascinating. Okay, back to the very beginning of the story. We have another question about, do we have any idea what happened to Mr. Goebel's siblings? Did he end up raising them after his mother passed away? Do we know?
Well, you know, he was the youngest of four, and he did help, he did raise the, you know, the two younger ones for a while. I've never researched that level of family detail to know whatever happened to them. His brother, I want to say his brother, you know, died in the 40s. You know, there, I've been researching, you know, the family, and I haven't been able to come up with a lot. Like, I've tried to spend some time just trying to find out about the, you know, Goebel's religion and stuff. Cause I made the assumption early in almost as a thesis in terms of researching him, you know, thinking, well, he was a German Catholic from that. And I've not been able to, and maybe somebody who's listening here may know, but I haven't been able to find anything, for example, on the family's religion. My suspicion is that they're German Protestants. I've not been able to find any record that shows that they were German Catholics in Northern Kentucky. So I've struggled to find some of those real personal family details, you know, like that. But I've never researched the outcome of where his siblings and what their fate was.
Gotcha. Well, if anyone's not watching the chat, I will just comment that there is a very detailed conversation going on about Sanford Town. And so we should all learn a little bit more. It's like literally like a mile from my house. So clearly I need to learn more about where I live. Bob and John,
I was just going to mention in researching that and stuff, a lot of people would call him Sanford, but there was also some people who called the banker, the person that Goebel killed, Sanford, S-A-N-D. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, so, you know, through history, he would get both of those spellings of his name, and he's buried very close to Sanford Town then, because he's buried in Highland Cemetery.
Okay. Yeah. I did get a note on Facebook that from Will Turwort, who says that he had read that Henry Yountsey was going to be the personal secretary of GOP Governor William Taylor. So maybe that had something to do with kind of whatever happened. I just realized that we did not do our quiz. I'm sure we have some people who are like wishing, you know, they had asked about it. Okay, I don't know if we can really do it now, but let's try it and just everybody get your fingers ready. John, do you want to deliver it? Because
you know what, Tara, I don't have it right in front of me, but
you don't have it right in front of you. Okay.
Let me, do you have it in front of you? You can do it.
I think I do. Well, it's not like right in front of me, but I think I can try to pull it up super fast. Okay. While I'm pulling this up, I did want to let everybody know that next week, we are going to have an awesome presentation by, a previous guest, Stuart Sanders, and he is going to give a presentation about the Battle of Perryville and how it relates to some of the things that were happening here in Northern Kentucky. You know, there was skirmishes up here. We've talked extensively with Janine Kreinbrink about some of the batteries and different things in the sort of Battle of Cincinnati that wasn't. And then not long after that was the Battle of Perryville. As a graduate of Center College, not far from Perryville, I'm super excited about this coming presentation. So, I am.
I've got the question.
You got it? Okay. All right. So everybody,
you want me to ask?
Go ahead.
Okay. Okay. Why is it not correct to say that Goebel is the only U.S. governor to be shot and killed by an assassin? Why is that not correct?
All right. First correct answer gets one of our prizes, which is a Northern Kentucky History Hour button. All right. I think you've got like 30 seconds. And while while everyone's thinking about answering, let's see if we have, I have some notifications on Facebook. So let's see if, oh, okay. Our first correct answer, at least on Zoom, goes to Janine Kreinbrink, followed by Charlie and Barbara Jacobson. He was not governor when he was shot. So there you go. Let's see, Charlie and Barbara, congratulations. You and Janine Kreinbrink will be getting an NKY History Hour pin. So great job. I'm just gonna write that down. And we are, Carol, thank you for your correct answer as well. You're just a little bit later, but we are so glad that we were able to have you guys tonight. Bob and John, thank you so much. That was fun. That was really interesting. I think you really brought to life something that, you know, was kind of tricky. There's not a lot of photos, but you guys really, really added some color and some and real information about a famous Northern Kentuckian. So we thank you. Thank you. And I appreciate it. Hopefully we'll get to see you guys in person sometime soon. And yes, thank you very much. Have a great night, everybody. See you next week for Battle of Paradise. Good night.